When I come here to the topic, that is with respect to real-time operating system. Okay, I have completed all these topics. Now, second part of the unit 4, that is hardware-software co-design. Hardware-software co-design. The topics are fundamental issues in hardware-software co-design, computational models in embedded system design, hardware-software trade-offs, integration of hardware and firmware, and IC in circuit emulator. Okay, IC means circuit emulator. So we'll discuss all these topics. Okay, the topics are very concise. Okay, so let's discuss all these topics in this class itself. So first one, fundamental issues in hardware software design. Okay, so what are the, while dealing hardware software co design means what? So when a hardware is being developed, in order to make the hardware work out, we need some software. When the software is being developed, okay, we need the aspect of software to work on, because since the subject is about embedded system, okay, we need a coordination. We need a coordination between the hardware and software development. The topic itself says that, okay, hardware, software, co-design. So while designing hardware, okay, we must consider the software requirements. So while designing the software, we must consider the hardware requirements. Okay, so what are the general issues while dealing with these things? Selecting the model, how we are going to design either software or a hardware. Okay, whether it is for some mathematical purpose, analysis purpose, okay, or any monitoring purpose, like selecting the architecture. Okay, so we have to select some hardware, processor, a controller. So what type of architecture you need? Okay, next, selecting the language. So I have to make the hardware run. Okay, in order to do some programming, you need some language. Okay, with respect, by considering the language only, you have to write the program. So what is the language you are going to choose? Fourth one, partitioning system requirements into hardware and software. See, in operating system also, when we install in our laptop and we install any OS, we used to partition the hardware. Okay. By using some OS functions. Okay. So what are the partitioning system requirements into hardware? How we are making it partition, right? So these are the fundamental issues. Okay, so we have to select the model, what type of architecture, what is the language we are going to include, and what are the partition system requests. There are system requirements. Okay, so these are the issues in hardware software co-design. Second topic, computational models in embedded system design. Okay, so there will be, see here we have selecting the model, or discuss about selecting the model. So what are the different computational models? Okay, so first one is data flow graph model, DFG. See, while writing any program in Xilinx, VLSI, we used to follow behavioral model, data flow model, structural model, like similar fashion. Here also, by choosing embedded system design, there are a number of computational models. What is the model you are going to choose? Okay. So this is a data flow model. Okay. The data flow node. Okay. Some A, variable A, variable B. Okay. This data flow mode used to add these things, x equal to A plus B, and C variable directly given to an adder here, data flow mode. So y equal to A plus B plus C. Is the data flow graph model. Second one, control data flow graph model. Okay. See, while writing any program, we need a flow chart and we need an algorithm. Okay, consider this model like that. Here, control data flow graph model. So here, if you see this, this part is with respect to data flow graph model. There are some inputs A, B, some addition part.
Okay, here also some addition part included.
Okay.
So here the output is A plus B.
Okay.
Next here it is A. Here it is B. Here also A plus B. Output will get the same thing. Right. So what is the condition? What is the control? What is the condition or control here?
Okay.
This one. Control node. Decision method, flag equal to 1. Flag equal to 1, if it is true, then we will execute this data flow node. If it is false, we are not going to execute this data flow node. Okay, simple. Next one, state machine model. In state machine model, okay, you know, finite state machines are studied in STL. In state machine model, we are going to know about the states. For that, I have taken an example. Okay. FSM model, finite state machine model for automatic seatbelt warning system. Automatic seatbelt warning system. See, consider an automobile, a car. Here, this state is alarm off. Alarm off. Okay. Here, alarm on. And this state is waiting. So three states are there. Okay, alarm off states, alarm on state, waiting state. So at first, ignition key on. Okay. I entered the automobile, take a car, and I have on the ignition system. Okay, ignition key on. Then it will be waiting. Okay. For what? Since the ignition key on, then we are going about to travel, we must on our seat belt. Okay, immediately what it has to do, the seat belt must on. Okay, seat belt must on. So alarm will get off. Okay, the state is alarm off and ignition key on. It will be waiting, and after the respective time, okay, for example, after starting the ignition, the driver not wearing the seat belt, so within 5 seconds the alarm has to be get off. This is the timer expired. The waiting time is plus 5 seconds. I have taken. Okay. I am considering it as a 5 seconds. Okay, it may be 1 second also. It may be some microseconds also. It's a programmer wish. So the ignition key on, first one is ignition key on. Within the minimum time, that is 5 seconds, if he not wear his seat belt, the alarm must get on. Okay? Alarm must get on. If the seat belt is on, okay, then alarm will get off. When will get off? If the alarm timer expired, or if the seat belt is on, or the ignition key is off. Alarm will get off when if we wear the seat belt, or if the ignition key is off. Okay, if the ignition key is on, you must wear the seat belt. Okay, if the passenger or the driver not wear the seat belt, then alarm will get on. Now, alarm will get off when the timer expired, or the seat belt is on, or ignition key off. Okay. So these are the conditions. Okay. This condition, alarm off condition, waiting condition, and alarm on condition. These are the states. Okay. This is one type of model. First one is data flow graph model. Control. Data flow graph model, state machine model, and this is the example for automatic belt warning system, seat belt warning system, and this is an example for a timer. Okay, so this state is idle state, this is a ready state. Okay, in order to get the timer on, these are the states. This is the running state. Okay, so here event is loading the timer. Event is we are loading the timer. Okay. Here we are starting the timer. Event is starting the timer. If the event is loading the timer, then timer count equal to new count. Okay. If you load the timer, then the states change from idle to ready state. Okay. Then if it starts, the timer is going to start, then the state changes from ready to running. So what will happen? Well, the state change from ready to running, the timer will be decremented. Okay, MRI will be action is decrementing the count. Okay, then from running state to idle state. Means if the timer expired, the state changes from running to idle, or the timer stops, it will change from running to idle. See, these are the states. Next, FSM model from automatic TR coffee vending machine. Okay, so here this is state A, different states. Okay. State A, state B, state C, state D. Okay. And the state A is waiting for coin. Mentioned there. Okay. State A is waiting for coin. Okay. So event. Okay. Event is waiting for coin. Then we have inserted the coin. Okay. Actually is okay. Next, if it is cancelled, coin will get out. These are the states. Okay. So if you insert the coin, next if you want T, okay, T button, we have to press the T button. If you want coffee, we have to press the coffee button. Okay. With respect to state C and D, respect to T or coffee will be dispensed. After respect to T or coffee dispensed, okay, it will return to state A. After coffee dispensed, return to state A. Okay, C to A, D to A. Clearly given. Okay. Wait for user input. B. Waiting for user input. User input is what? Coin. Okay. State C, dispense T. Okay. State D, dispense coffee. After dispensing coffee, what is happening? Return to the state A. So, this is example for state machine model. Right. Next, sequential program model. One by one. So first one, ignition key on, waiting for 10 seconds, after ignition key on, same example, okay, I think, seatbelt example, ignition key on, we are waiting for 10 seconds, okay, when the ignition key is on, taking the condition box here, okay, if it is yes, the ignition key is on, okay, if it is yes, then we have to check for seatbelt on or off, okay, whether the passenger is wearing seatbelt or not. The ignition key is off, okay. No, the ignition key is not on, then we return to the anchor process. If the ignition key is on, then the seatbelt is not, you have to check the seatbelt condition. Okay, if he is not wearing seatbelt on, yes, then it's okay, return to the anchor. If he is not wearing seatbelt, no, seatbelt is not on, ignition key, yes, on. Okay, seat belt is not an on position. No, then we have to set the timer for 5 seconds to start the alarm. Okay, after the alarm generation also, again we have to check for whether ignition key on or not. The ignition key still is on condition, then he has to check again the seat belt condition. The seat belt condition is yes, okay, seat belt is on, then we have to stop alarm. Seatbelt is on, have to stop alarm. Yes, stop alarm. Seatbelt condition is no. The passenger or driver not wearing the seatbelt, again, have to check for the time. Right. So, this is the same example. This is the same example in the with respect to seatbelt. Okay, that is sequential program model. Previously, we have discussed the same example with respect to state machine model. Right. This is a sequential program model. This one is concurrent or communicating progress model. Okay. Means there are concurrency. Okay. Means n number of modules will be executing and connecting, okay, in a path and executing at the same time. Okay. With minimum delay. With minimum delay. Okay. So it is said to be concurrent or program model or progress model. So last one is object-oriented model. Okay. So this is a programming model where we define a class and an object. The class consists of an object and these are objects are said to be identical. So object is an entity used for representing or modeling a particular piece of a system. Means it is an entity, okay, which represents some state, some behavior. And each object is characterized by a set of unique behavior and state, as mentioned. Okay. this is about the object-oriented model. So, I have completed the second topic. First topic is fundamental issues in hardware software code design. Okay. In that, now we have discussed about different models, computational models. Okay. Second is about architecture, language, and partition. Okay. So, I completed two topics: fundamental issues in hardware software code design and computational models in embedded system design. Okay. Next topic is hardware software trade-offs. Hardware software trade-offs. Okay. Trade-offs means considerations. Okay. Considerations. What has to be increased? What has to be decreased? Some negotiation. Okay. Some negotiation between hardware and software. Okay. So what are they? So trade-offs means what has to be decreased. While dealing with any hardware and software, what have to consider? Okay. In which part we have the software has some patch step. Okay. That is processing speed and performance. Okay. So with respect to processing speed, okay, we have to consider which one is speed. Okay, there is a hardware or a software. Which one you have to consider? Which one is the best? Which gives the better performance by taking a software timer or a hardware timer? Next, frequency. Frequency of change. That is reconfigurability. So after designing the particular hardware and software, is there any need to reconfigure that? Third one, memory size and gate count. Okay, memory size must be high, the gate count must be low. So with the minimum gate count, we have to provide a good amount of memory. Yes, how is it reliable? And last one is man hours, effort and cost. So in order to develop the respective software or hardware, okay, how much effort and what is the cost? Okay, how much cost the respective hardware will take. Okay. How much cost the respective software? Okay. Software need to be considered in order to develop that. Right. So these are the trade-offs between hardware and software. Next, integration of hardware and firmware. Integration means combining the hardware and software. Means we are simply dumping the respective code into hardware. Okay. Integrating them, combining them. First one, how will you integrate? How you will include a respective program in the hardware? First one, out of circuit program. Means, let's go through. The processor or memory chip into which the firmware needs to be embedded, okay, program which are going to include in the hardware, is taken out of the target board and is programmed with the help of a programming device. So you need to program a device. We'll simply take out a chip, program it. Okay, program it in a programming device. So there are specialized devices. You need to program a microcontroller. Okay, you need to include the respective microcontroller in this software. Okay, then you will need to program. So you will need a separate device not to program the respective one. That is out of circuit programming. Second one, out of circuit programming. So this is how we program. Okay. So interfacing our device programming with PC. This is a PC on all this, and this is the communication port. And this is some programming device programmer. You will include your respective device here and you will program. Later you will take the respective chip and include in the application where we are using. It's just an example about the peripherals, the programmer, the device programmer is an example for out-of-circuit programming. But taking the chip out, programming, and reinserting in the application device. Second one, in-system programming, ISP. With ISP, programming is done within the system. Okay. Programming is done within the system. Meaning, the firmware is embedded into the target device without removing from the target port. Here, in out-of-circuit programming, we have removed it from the target board. Here we are not removing from the target board. Programming is done within the system itself. Okay. Next, in-application programming. In-application programming. Okay. It is used by firmware running on the target device for modifying a selected portion of the code. Remember, selected portion. Here, In out-of-circuit programming, take the device out and program it. In circuit programming, by connecting only, within the system only we have programmed. In application programming, we are modifying the selected portion, not all, are modifying the selected portion, that is in application programming.
Okay.
It modifies the program code memory under the control of the embedded application.
Okay.
We are modifying only the selected part where it required in the system itself. This one is in application programming. Next, use of factory programmed chip. Use of factory programmed chip means what? It is possible to embed the firmware into the target processor control memory at the time of the chip fabrication itself. Okay, so I have developed the device, I simulated it, synthesized it, given the file to some factory to manufacture it, and they have given the chip, and we are simply using the pre-programmed one.
Okay,
such chips are known as factory programmed chips. Okay, once the firmware design is over and the firmware achieved operational stability, the firmware files can be sent to the chip fabricator to embed into the code memory.
Okay,
once we simulated it,
okay,
checked the syntax, simulation done, synthesis done, it's working on the board, FPGA, CPLD, then we will send the respective files to the factory to manufacture the respective chip for the respective function only. That is use of factory programmed chip. So this is how we are integrating hardware and firmware. First one is out-of-circuit programming, in-circuit programming, in-system programming, in-application programming, use of factory programmed chip.
Okay.
Next, firmware loading for operating-based device.
Okay.
Nothing but we are loading the respective firmware. Okay. Firmware loading for operating system-based devices. So there are some devices which needs then OS. Okay. Embedded firmware as an OS. So how will we load? The OS-based embedded systems are programmed using the ISP technique, in-system programming. See, we are connecting the system only, connecting the boot pen drive to our system only, we are formatting the drives, installing the new OS, operating system Windows 7 or Windows 10, same technique. OS-based embedded systems contain a special piece of code called bootloader.
Okay.
This bootloader used to install the respective OS in the hardware. This is how we install the respective OS in the our laptops or desktops, which takes control of the OS and application firmware embedding and copying of the OS image to the RAM of the system for execution. See, simply this is nothing but installing the respective some Windows operating system in our laptop. Okay, there are some bootable devices. There will be a boot menu, okay, which we will send the respective OS through a boot menu to the pen drive. So by booting the pen drive, the respective operating system is loaded in your laptop or desktop. Next, last topic, ICE.
Okay.
In-circuit emulator.
Okay.
An ICE, in-circuit emulator, also called, on-circuit debugger, OCD, or background debug module, BDM. ICE is also called ICE, in-circuit emulator is also called on-circuit debugger, OCD, or background debug module, BDM.
Okay.
See, in-circuit emulator, emulator means imitator. It imitates the target processor. It's a hardware device used to debug the software of an embedded application. Means we are not going to directly connect the hardware, but using an in-circuit emulator, it will imitate the target processor, and we can test whether it's work on the target processor or not. That is in-circuit emulator. In-circuit emulator can also refer to the use of hardware emulation when emulator is plugged into a system in place of yet to be built chip. So after emulation successfully completed, then we are going to manufacture the chip. These in-circuit emulators provide a way to run the system with live data while still allowing relatively good debugging capabilities. See, here we are going to include the respective target processor here. Where we want to target processor here, where we want to. Okay. Next, this is the system PC, in-circuit emulator, here, target system emulating circuit. So, what does this do? It will imitate the processor microcontroller inserted here. Okay. So, we are going to test the respect to code, okay, code in the in-circuit emulator. Because if there is any fault, the in-circuit emulator will be taken. Okay. So by testing on this in-circuit emulator, okay, you can make sure that whether the respective code will work on the target processor or not. Okay. So in-circuit emulator, okay, emulator imitates the target processor connected here. Imitate the target processor connected here. Okay. So this is about in-circuit emulator. So I have studied about fundamental issues in hardware software code design, computational models, okay, hardware software trade-offs, integration of hardware and firmware. Last one is in-circuit emulator. Summary is, I studied about hardware software code design, okay, computational models, very different computational models, hardware software trade-offs. Important thing is about IC, in-circuit emulator. Okay, hardware software computational fundamental issues, computational models, hardware software trade-offs. Okay. This one, integration of hardware and firmware, and in-circuit emulator. Thank you.